Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals. And by viewers like you.
And welcome to Homework Hotline. I'm Joe Zniga.
And I'm Laura Drake. Homework Hotline is a place where you can get help with your homework on the phone, online, or right here on TV.
And here's how the show works. Now there's teachers from Dowell, teachers standing by right now to take your call and help you with your homework.
If you'd like help with your homework, call Dial a Teacher free at 888-986-2345.
All right, now you can also send us your comments on our new website, homeworkoutline.org. Click on the Yak Back button and send in your comments.
We'll get back to our first question in a minute, but first, let's get to tonight's creature teaser. If you have a termite problem, this creature might be able to help you out. They use their long snouts to help them eat their favorite food, termites. This creature can be found in Africa and has rabbit-like ears and a tail similar to that of a kangaroo.
All right, now this creature is nocturnal, which means it sleeps during the day and not at night. Now, while awake at night, this animal travels several miles to look for its food.
If you think you can solve the creature teacher, give our hotline a call at 1-866-264-5904 or just answer it on our website, homeworkhotline.org. Answer correctly and you could have a chance to share the answer at the end of the show.
Now every correct response will be at our Hotline Hall of Fame, and if you earn enough points, you can win a spot or you can win a tablet at the end of the season. All right. Now we got a creature teaser teacher here.
Creature teaser.
That's okay. You know what? I want to say something quick before our first call.
Yeah.
I want to give a shout out to my new nephew Steven.
Aww.
And congratulate his parents and his siblings. He's
Aww.
about 5 hours old now, so
oh,
I hope he's watching
that's
the
so
show.
Exciting.
It's time to start learning, right? Okay.
All right. So we are ready with our first caller.
Hello.
Hello.
Hi. Who's this?
Zoe.
Hi, Zoe. Hi, Zoe. I'm gonna go over to the board to help you out with your problem. Okay.
Okay.
What grade are you in, Zoe?
Fifth.
Fifth grade. Okay, I love it. So, Zoe, what is the problem you have for us today?
The problem I have for you today is estimating products.
Estimating okay. products. Okay.
Yeah. Okay, so the problem is a bus service drives passengers between Milwaukee and Chicago every day. They travel from city to city a total of 8 times each day.
How many times each day, Zoe? Slow down for a minute. How many times each day?
8 times.
8 times each day. Okay. Keep going.
The distance between the two cities is 89 miles.
Okay.
In the month of February, there are 28 days. The company's budget allows for 28,000 total miles for February. Is 28,000 miles a reasonable budget mileage amount?
Okay, so let me go over all the notes that I have from you, and I'm sure I missed a few, okay? So a bus is going from Milwaukee to Chicago. It's going 8 times a day, and the distance between Milwaukee and Chicago is 89 miles, right? And February has 28 days. And there was one other piece of information, something about a budget.
Yeah, the budget allows 28,000 total miles for February.
Okay, 28,000 miles for February. Awesome. Okay. And then we want to find out, is that a good budget, right? Is 28,000 miles enough? Does that kind of make sense with what we're doing, right?
Yep.
Okay. Got any ideas where you want to start? We have so much information all over the place. What do you think you want to start with?
Estimating 28,889.
Okay, so we're looking at, we have the 28 days, right? And we also know that it goes 8 times a day, and 8 times a day is 89 miles, right? So we want to see whether somehow all this piece, this whole big piece up here, is going to be somewhere around 28,000 miles. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to start over here seeing that I know that there are 28 days in February, and if I knew how many miles there was every day, I would probably be able to figure out the budget. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Okay, so how can we figure out how many miles the bus does every single day?
So first we could use rounding. We could estimate. We could estimate the numbers and we could try to multiply it.
Okay, that sounds like a great idea. And why do we want to round when we're estimating?
Because if we don't round, it wouldn't be a good estimation.
So right, when we're estimating, the idea is to just make the numbers as friendly and as easy as possible, but still kind of get an answer that's near the ballpark. Does that, okay? So when we look at this number, we're going to look at the number 89, right?
Yes.
I don't think of that as a really friendly number. I can't skip count by 89s. I can't multiply by 89 in my head. What number do you think 89 is kind of we could round up to that's an easy number to use?
90.
90? I think 90 is pretty good. Are you pretty sure that it's... let me just double check with you a question, okay? So is it 89 miles from Milwaukee to Chicago? What would they say about the 89 miles? Or was it 89 miles for the whole trip?
The distance between the two cities is 89 miles.
Okay, great. And it's just going 8 times a day. So we don't know that it's going round trip. So it's 8 trips of 89, right? So we're going to take 89 and we're going to make it 90 miles. Is that the number you want to go with?
Yep.
Okay. I'm going to kind of think that 100 might be easier, but you're feeling pretty confident that you can multiply by 90 in your head?
Yeah, no.
All right, so do you think you could multiply by hundreds in your head? Would that be a little bit easier?
Yep.
Okay, so let's try multiplying by hundreds, okay? So we know that we are going to round up to 100. We're going to pretend that this is the number 100. Kind of a little wishful thinking. I wish that number was an 89. I wish it was an easier number like 100. So let's make it 100, okay? So it's going to go 100 miles. And how many times is it going to go 100 miles?
8.
It's going to go 8 times. So what number would we get? And I'm going to write this out, but I'm hoping that you can do this in your head because that's why it's estimating. What number would you get?
800.
800, right? And that's why we use the 100. So it's going to do 800 miles per day because we did 8 times about 100, right?
Yes.
Awesome. So now there's 28 days in February, okay? So what we could do is we could multiply 28 times 800, right?
Okay.
But is that something you can do in your head?
No.
No, that doesn't make it too easy, right? So we're going to actually take a step back and we're going to think backwards for a minute. So we know that the budget is there's 28,000 miles in for the whole month and there's 28 days in February, right?
Yes.
So how many miles would that be a day? What would 28,000 divided by 28 be? How many 28s going to 28,000?
28.
Oh, nope, because 28 doesn't go into 28 times, okay? So when I think about it, this is 28 thousands. So I have 28 groups of 1,000. So 28 goes into 28 1,000 times, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so that would be the first day would be 1,000, the second day would be 1,000, the third day would be 1,000 until we get to the number 28,000. So we're saying that she gets the bus company kind of gets to spend 1,000 miles each day, okay?
Yes.
But what did we figure out that they were doing each day?
We figured out that they were
doing how many miles each day did we figure out?
800
miles each day, right?
Yes.
And the bus company said that they could have 1,000 miles a day. So what do you think? Do you think that they've budgeted enough miles? Are they too big or too small? The bus company. The bus company said 1,000 and they only need 800. So the bus company has budgeted more than enough. Does that make sense to you?
Yeah.
Okay, so instead of having 800, they gave it 1,000, so there's even a room for another trip or two in there in case they have to do it, okay?
Uh-huh.
Great. Thanks for calling, Zoe. I love doing that problem with you.
Thank you.
I said, hey.
Need help with your homework? Find the number for where you live and then make the call.
Okay, we have Dwayne on the line. Hi, Dwayne, are you there?
Yes.
Hi, Dwayne, how are you today?
I'm fine, are you?
Good, thank you. Now, you're a sixth grader?
Yes.
And where do you go to school?
I go to school at Poughkeepsie Middle School.
Poughkeepsie Middle School, great. All right, let me go to the board because I understand you have a math question, right?
Yes.
Okay, what's the question we're working on?
It's ratio.
Okay. You want to read me the question? Is it a word question?
Okay.
All right.
The ratio of cats to dogs at four-legged friends pet store is 8-7.
Okay.
If four-legged friends has 48 cats, how many dogs does it have?
All right. Now, did you say 28 cats?
48.
48 cats. So there's 48 cats. All right. So we know they have 48 cats, and the ratio you said is 8-7 cats to dogs, right?
Yes.
Here's what I always like to look at first. What do they have more of, cats or dogs?
More dogs.
Okay.
Cats.
So we got to make sure that if we our ratio, it's easy to get this reversed. We know at the end our answer better have less than 48, right? There shouldn't be as many dogs. Okay, good. Now, were you told to do this in a specific way? Did you have to use a tape diagram, or could you just divide it out? How were you told to do this?
Well, we have to use a tape diagram.
You do have to use a tape diagram. Okay. Now, that's a big thing in sixth grade right now. What is a tape diagram? Tell everybody what we need to do here, or is that where you're stuck?
I'm just stuck on how to use it.
On how to use it. Okay. When we do a tape diagram, right? Do you do something? Do you do something like this, and then the same thing for the cats and the dogs, right? Do it like that?
Yes.
Okay, good. So this is dogs. Oh wait, we just do cats first. All right. All right. So cats, and then dogs, right? Now tell me what we got to do next.
Okay. So now we have to look at the ratio from 8-7.
Okay, so for my cat's box, how many boxes do I have to divide this into?
The cats were 8.
8, okay, so let me sure I count right. 1, 2. So let me sure I count. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Good. And so how many boxes do I need for the dogs?
7.
7. Make sure I did that correctly. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. All right, good. So far, so good, right?
Yeah.
All right. Now, this is the tape yard. This is our ratio. We know for every 8 cats, we're going to have 7 dogs, right?
Yes.
Now, what's the next thing? You got this 48 cats. How can we use that?
Well, 48. We can...
All right, let me see if I can help you out here. Oh, go ahead.
I need help.
Okay, all right. If we counted each one of these as being one cat, we could continue out making these until we had 48 boxes of cats and see how many boxes of dogs we had, right?
Yeah.
All right, but we could save ourselves time because notice they said that this ratio is going to stay constant no matter how many of these we have, right?
Yeah.
All right. So we know that we have a total of 48 cats. Some multiple of 8 has got to be the number of boxes we would have, right?
Yes.
Does that make sense? How many times is 8 going to 48?
8 going to 48, 6.
6. So we know that if we did this, if we had a 6 and a 6 and a 6, 6, 6, 6, and 6.
Or to make it easier, we can just do 6 times 8.
6 times 8 is our 48, right? You're absolutely right. So here, that represents 48 cats, right? Okay?
Yes.
If we had 6 sets of these things, we would have that, right?
Yep.
Okay? But how many dogs do we have here? Well, we know that we would have to do it 6 times here also, right?
So we would have to do 6 times 7, and that would equal 42.
You got it. Nice job. So you got it without even me telling you. And that's 42 what? 42 dogs, right?
Yes.
Because we always want to label our answer. Very good. So you saw that ratio stayed constant. Oops. What did I hit? Okay. That ratio stayed constant, right? Okay. And so you did it excellent. You divided, you got 6, and you saw that 6 times 7 was going to give you your 42. Nice job.
Yes.
All right.
Thank you.
Do you got more like that?
Well, probably tomorrow.
Okay, as I say, if you got more, try them, call Dial a Teacher and they'll check your answers for you. But I think you got it down. Nice job.
Thank you. All right, thank you.
Thank you. Thanks for calling.
An easy way to remember your order of operations is PEMDAS. Please excuse my dear Aunt Sally. Parentheses, exponents, multiplication, division, addition, and subtraction.
We'll get back to our homework in just a minute, but first, in tonight's Zoofily, we head to the Seneca Park Zoo in Rochester, New York, to find out more about the pied tamarin. Take a look.
The scientific name of the pied tamarin is sanguineus bicolor. There are many different types of tamarins. They range in size, facial features, tail length, geographic habitat where they might live, and they're all found in South America, so they are all considered old world monkeys. Old world monkeys are found in Europe and Asia and Africa, and they are a little bit more of a primitive primate. They also have a little bit flatter faces, and they have outfacing nostrils. Pied tamarins are located north of Manaus, Brazil, and that's the only place that pied tamarins are located. They live in secondary rainforests, not quite so high up in the trees as the golden eyed tamarins. They live near swamp edges, and they also will live on white sand beaches. Their habitat loss is one of their greatest problems that they're facing right now. The pied tamarins are interesting to me because they have little meaty hands. The golden eyed tamarin's hands are very slender and very long fingers, and the pied tamarins have very large hands for their size. And they do have the claw-like nail, like the golden lions do. They'll go after insects with their hands. They like to pull things apart. And they're also diurnal. They're active during the day, and they are arboreal. They will come down to the ground to look for insects and for worms and things like that on the ground, but for the most part, they spend the most time of their other lives in the trees. They will sleep in small cavities to protect themselves from predators. Their predators are very similar to the golden-eyed tamarin predators, ocelots, large cats, large snakes, eagles, large raptors. So they'll protect themselves by sleeping in the hollowed out cavities in trees. The pied tamarins are a little bit smaller than the golden-eyed tamarins. They range between 8 to 12 inches long, with their tail length being 12 to 15 inches long. Their tails are longer than their bodies for the most part, and they do use them for balance when they're maneuvering around in the treetops. When they're leaping from branch to branch, they'll use their tail for balance. A prehensile tail is a tail that they can actually wrap around a branch and help them maneuver through the trees, and they can sometimes hang by their tail. The tamarins cannot. They do not have a prehensile tail. The pied tamarins eat mostly fruit. They will eat insects. They will eat bird eggs, small reptiles. When food is scarce, they'll go after the sap or the gum, the tree gum. But they are endangered, so they are protected. And we have a breeding program with them here. So the pied tamarins will utilize their males in babysitting. Moms will take care of the babies for the first week or so, and then they'll pass the daycare on to the dads, and then the fathers will pass them back to the mothers for nursing. Pied tamarins will live in groups. They have multi-male and multi-female groups. They're just one big happy family.
All right, now if you want to see this segment again or others like it, you can go to our website, our new website, homeworkhotline.org, and click on videos.
All right.
But now we're going to see you do some math, I think, right?
I do believe so. Do we have Taylor on the phone?
Hello?
Hello?
Hi, Taylor. You got a math problem for me?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm going to go over to the board. What grade are you in?
Eighth
grade. Do you love math? Do you love eighth grade?
Yes, I love 8th grade.
All right, good. I love 8th graders, too. Okay, Taylor, what's your math problem for me?
Okay, x over 3.
Oh, yeah?
Plus x over 4.
Okay.
Equals 7.
Equals 7. Huh, so you have to solve for x, I'm going to guess?
Yes.
Okay, so the thing that makes this problem not so fun is that it is a what?
We have fractions.
We have fractions, right? So one strategy that I've learned that's really helped me out is to get rid of the fractions, okay? And I never used to know this strategy, and someone shared it with me recently. So I'm going to share it with you, and you might love it, and I hope you do, okay? So we don't want the fractions in here, right? Because they're hard to deal with. So what we're going to do is we're going to, and maybe your teacher does it this way too, is that you're going to come up with the least common multiple of the bottom number. So you have a 3 and a 4, and what's the smallest number that 3 and 4 go into?
12.
So they both go into 12, right? So what we're going to do is we are going to multiply both sides of the equation by the number 12. Okay?
Okay.
All right. Might seem a little crazy, but we're okay right now. So when we multiply both sides of the equation by 12, we're going to use the distributive property. What's 12 times x?
12x.
And you know when we multiply it that we don't multiply the 12 times the 3. It's just the 12 times the numerator, right? So we're just going to leave it 12x over 3. And now we're going to add 12 times x gets you 12 times x 12x. Again is 12x over 4. And then we have to do 7 times 12. Can you do that one in your head?
No.
Okay, 7 times 10 is 70, plus 7 times 2 is 14, so we get 84. Okay?
Okay.
Awesome. Now, here is the cool part of this problem. When I reduce these, my fractions are going to disappear. What is 12 divided by 3? 12x divided by 3 is 4x, okay? And 12 divided by 4 is?
3.
3x. Equals 84. And voila, your fractions have now disappeared, and now it's just a pretty easy problem to work on, okay?
Okay.
So what are we going to do now?
Combine like terms.
Combine like terms, and 4x plus 3x is? 4 plus 3 more?
7x.
7x equals 84, right?
Yeah.
And now's the easy part. What are we going to do to get the x alone?
Divide each side by 7.
By 7. And that one should be pretty easy because I think we just multiplied something by 7, didn't we?
Yeah.
What's 84 divided by 7? We just did it. To get the 84, we multiplied it by 7. It's 12, okay?
12.
So the answer is x equals 12. So that was pretty cool, right? Do you like how the fraction disappeared?
Yeah.
Okay, great. So now we're going to check this real fast, okay? We just want to make sure that it's right. So we're going to do a quick check. All right, and so we're going to take the original equation, and what are we going to do to check it? We're going to substitute in the 12 every place we saw an x, right?
Yes.
Okay, so we're going to do 12 over 3 plus 12 over 4 equals 7, and we're going to see if that's true, okay? So what's, Taylor, what's 12 divided by 3?
4.
4. And 12 divided by 4?
3
equals 7, and 4 plus 3 is 7, so 7 equals 7, okay?
Okay.
Did you like
that
little trick? Did that help you out?
Yeah.
The magic fractions disappearing. All right. Thanks, Taylor, for calling.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
All right. We got a winner in our creature teaser. Matthew, are you there? Hello? Oh, Matthew, I hope we didn't lose you. Well, Matthew, you're going to get credit. Hopefully, I can get you on, but Matthew knew that our answer was the aardvark.
The aardvark.
Okay. Are you back, Matthew?
Yeah.
Oh, great.
Yay.
All right, Matthew, I'm sorry I stole your thunder, but what was the answer?
Aardvark.
Very good. Now, what grade are you, Matthew?
Good.
Third, very good. Now, how'd you know that?
I watched it for the show.
Yeah, well, and you like aardvarks. Have you seen aardvarks, pictures of them?
Yeah.
They're very funny looking, aren't they?
Yeah.
Yeah, but they like termites. Can you imagine a meal of just termites? No?
Yeah.
And do you know how they get them out of the termite mounds?
They dig them out.
Yeah, they are good diggers, they are. Mm-hmm. But they have a really long, sticky tongue. Did you know that?
Yeah.
Yeah, their tongue can be like a foot long.
Wow.
And they can stick it down in those holes and pull out termites and eat them. But glad I'm not an aardvark. How about you? you did a great job, Matthew. Now, where do you go to school?
Huh?
Where do you go to school?
St. Gregory.
St. Gregory's? Well, I hope your teachers are watching because you did a great job. Thanks for calling, okay? All right, congratulations, Matthew. Now, don't forget, though, every correct response goes in our Homework Hotline Hall of Fame. And earn enough points, you could win a tablet at the end of the season.
Well, that's all the time we have for tonight. We are saying goodbye, but dial teachers available free homework help on the phone until 7 o'clock tonight.
All right, now tomorrow we'll have the creator of Cam Jam here on set, and cool. He'll be even showing some of our students and Craig how to play, so that's something you won't want to miss.
All right.
Good night.
Looking forward to it. Good night.
Homework Hotline is supported in part by New York State United Teachers. NYSUT's 600,000 members are building a brighter future in New York State classrooms, universities, and healthcare facilities. NYSUT, a union of professionals, and by viewers like you.